Tell you what, that grace is amazing. You know why that grace is amazing?
Yes.
It's amazing because it's applied to me. It's amazing to me because it's applied to somebody that's just like me. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. That grace is amazing. You know, the more you walk with Christ, the more it will be revealed to you just what you really are in comparison to God. Understand what our salvation is. Jesus Christ suffered and died despite being perfectly righteous so you and I could have a relationship with the Almighty God despite being sinful. That's what our salvation is, and it's available to sinners, and that's why that grace is so amazing. Amen?
Yeah,
amen. It's amazing because it's available to us. It's amazing because someone like God extends it to people like us. Amen? Praise God. The grace is amazing. That song has been, since its inception until now, probably the greatest hymn of Christianity because it so well sums up our salvation. Amen?
Amen.
Man, I want to keep going on that. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, turn to John chapter 20. John chapter 20. We're going to, I know I told you what my key verse was going to be before I started, but we're actually going to, we're going to start in verse 19. John chapter 20, starting in the 19th verse. When you're there, say amen.
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 Amen. All right. John chapter 20, verse 19 says, "Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said to them, 'Peace be unto you.' And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then Jesus said to them again, 'Peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so send I you.'" Peace be unto you. "As my Father has sent me, even so send I you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, 'Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained.'" Notice the words that Jesus says in the 21st verse. He says, "As my Father has sent me, even so I send you." He makes a comparison to the sending that he was given, that his Father sent him, and compares that to how he has sent us. And this morning we're going to take a look at why that is. So this morning we're going to be preaching a message titled simply as my, the title of the message is His Mission, Our Commission. His Mission, Our Commission. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I ask that you would continue to move in this service with your Holy Spirit. The same Spirit we felt, Lord, coming in, the same Spirit during the worship is that same Spirit, Lord God, we ask to be during the preaching, that my mouth would say exactly what it is that you would have said, Lord, and that their ears would hear exactly what you would have them hear, Lord. Lord, feed your people your bread this morning. Feed them what they need for today. Not just what they'll need for the coming week, Lord, but especially what they need to hear and what they need to eat today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. So again, Jesus here makes a comparison between his Father sending him and he himself sending us. There is a comparison between his mission and our commission. Why is that? This comparison is not just, hey, I was sent, and you guys are being sent too. You know, he wasn't just making a simple little statement like that. Obviously, we know he was sent. Obviously, we know that the disciples were being sent. But why did Jesus feel the need to use such an important visitation? Why did he go to that first? Think of it. He has just risen from the dead. The disciples are cowering in a room because they don't believe in the resurrection. They did not expect Jesus to rise from the dead. They were so afraid that since the Jews had put Jesus to death, put yourself in their shoes. The Jews had already been planning to put him to death. They had tried to stone him. They had tried to throw him off a cliff. And the disciples, though, they watched how Jesus was able to get out of all those situations. Jesus was there to protect himself from that in that sense. He was protecting them. He was with them. Again, he provided that protection from the Jews. They had that confidence because they had Jesus with them. They saw the miracles, so they weren't all that afraid of the Jews. But because they did not understand what Jesus' purpose was, and they did not believe in the resurrection, when the Jews came and successfully put Jesus to death, oh man, our master, the miracle worker, the Jews had put him to death. And everyone knows we're his followers. Peter had already denied even knowing him 3 times. Now that the death was actually carried out, they were all afraid, hiding in a room for fear of the Jews. And Jesus, this is his first appearance to all of the disciples together. He had already appeared to Mary, right? Mary had already delivered news, but this is the first time that Jesus appears to his disciples after the resurrection. And so, if you were to look at this as just him saying, hey, by the way, my Father sent me, and I'm sending you guys, just to point out that we're both being sent, hey, you know, it's not a little point here. It's not that small of a point. This is the first meeting with Jesus after the resurrection with the disciples. This is a critical point. He is, well, first of all, trying to deal with the fear in their hearts. Not only are they afraid of the Jews, but then all of a sudden, someone appears through the walls. Okay, that's a frightening thing. And he says, peace be unto you. Shows them the wounds in his hands and his side. Because perhaps they didn't even know it was Jesus. But when they saw the nail prints in his hands and they saw the wound in his side, they were comforted. This is Jesus. He has risen from the dead.
Amen.
But the first thing he says to them after saying peace to you, showing them his hands inside, the first thing he says to them, this critical piece of information given to them, is just as my Father has sent me, so send I you. He was passing a torch to them. He was delivering them the same responsibility that he himself was given. Think about it. Jesus Christ came to die on Calvary's cross to bring salvation to men. He came halfway at that point. And by halfway, don't misunderstand what I'm saying. The cross was the whole thing. It was all the way. It was all our salvation, all our justification, all our sanctification, all our glorification. The cross was everything. But that was God offering salvation to men. That was God bringing salvation to the table. That was him filling the well of salvation. But now the responsibility was being passed on to the disciples to bring sinful man to that well. Jesus Christ came to give us the cross and then gave us the responsibility of bringing others to the cross. Do you see how that works? He came to present it and then said, okay, now you go and bring people to what I've done. His mission was to die on the cross for man's sins, and our commission is to bring people to the cross where that salvation is. And this is the first thing that Jesus says to them when he appears to them. This is the first thing he's saying, look, it's done. It's finished. I finished it on Calvary. I proved it in my resurrection. I've come back from the grave. Now you are to go. I'm sending you to do something. And of course, we see that Jesus later on instructs them and says, don't go anywhere until you're imbued with power from heaven, until you receive the Holy Ghost. And he gives a precursor to that even here in this meeting. When he blows on them, when he breathes on them, and he says, receive the Holy Ghost. At that point, they weren't actually receiving it. But and I love this connection here, is you have Jesus breathing on them and saying, receive the Holy Spirit, but then says, now wait until you actually receive it. Later on, he says, wait, tarry here in Jerusalem until you receive it. So when they're all in that upper room, and all of a sudden that wind from heaven starts blowing through the room and filling them with the Holy Spirit, in my mind, this is how I see it, their minds may have gone back
to that meeting they had right here with Jesus in the room. When that rushing mighty wind blew through all the house, I believe they went back. Because they're receiving the Holy Spirit. Their minds would have went back to this meeting right here, where Jesus said, receive the Holy Spirit and breathed on them. They thought, man, last time Jesus breathed on us, it was just a little bit of air from his lungs. But oh man, this time Jesus is breathing on us and it has filled all the house. Amen?
Amen.
And that was a little bit of an aside. I had to go there. But good. Now understand the passing of the torch, if you will. Jesus did his part. And by giving the Holy Spirit, he continues to do his part. Because without the drawing of the Holy Spirit, man can't come to the cross.
Right.
So it is the Holy Spirit that draws. But the responsibility is for you and I as believers to be filled with that Holy Spirit, to be filled with that wind from heaven, to be filled with the representative of Jesus on that earth, so that you and I can be representatives of Jesus on this earth. Jesus Christ, the first thing when he started his public ministry was for him to be baptized and to receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ received the Holy Spirit without measure. And that occurred, of course, when he was baptized by John in the Jordan River. When the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. So Jesus Christ, now he received the Holy Spirit without measure at the beginning of his ministry. Everything that Jesus did was in obedience to the Holy Spirit. And everything, understand this, that Jesus Christ did on earth, as far as miracles and everything else, he did not do as God. Understand something. Everything that Jesus Christ did on this earth, he did not do it as God. When Jesus Christ humbled himself and took upon himself the form of a lowly servant, he laid aside the expression of his deity. He didn't come down here to do things as God. He came down here to do things as a man. But not just a man, but a man empowered by the Holy Spirit. Of course, now you and I only receive a measure of the Holy Spirit according to the will of God. Jesus Christ received an unlimited measure of the Holy Spirit because he is God. So understand, I'm not saying he stopped being God. He never lost or put aside the possession of his deity, but he did lay aside the expression of it.
Yeah.
So Jesus Christ in his ministry needed the power of the Holy Spirit and expressed to us, and by needed I mean to do it as a man, needed the power of the Holy Spirit, and did that to show us that we need the Holy Spirit. So in obedience to the Spirit in all things, the Holy Spirit drew him to the cross. The Holy Spirit brought him to the cross. That was the entire point of his mission. So he goes through that whole mission, finishes it at the cross, goes through the resurrection, and then appears to the disciples and in their first meeting says, just as my Father sent me. What was he sent to do? To die on the cross. Just as my Father has sent me. Now I am sending you. Just as Jesus was given a mission, just as he was given a task by the Father, and he went willingly, and he went in the power of the Holy Spirit, he's saying, in that same way, I am sending you. That you and I have a mission to fulfill. We have been commissioned to do something. We have been sent by Christ, just as Christ has been sent by the Father. And just as Jesus needed the power of the Holy Spirit to do what he did, you and I, how much more, as sinful human beings, do we need the Holy Spirit to fulfill what we have got to do? Amen? You and I need the Holy Spirit, which is why he breathed on them. He said, I'm sending you, so receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. So now what I want to impress on you this morning is how crucial Christ's mission was. So that when you see how crucial his mission was, you'll understand how crucial your commission is. As Christians, sometimes we look at the Christian life as like a, it's like an add-on. It's like something I just have going in my life in addition to everything else. like my Christianity is just, you know, doing a few good things to some people, going to church on Sunday, and then waiting to get to heaven. That's not what our Christian life is all about. Our Christian lives are to be, are the whole point of them is for you and I to be conformed into the image of Christ by the Holy Spirit, so that you and I can be effective representatives of Jesus Christ on this earth and fulfill this task, fulfill this mission, which is a continuation of the mission of Christ himself. He went to the cross, and now our mission is to bring others to the cross. Amen. And just as crucial as his mission was, so too is our commission that crucial. Amen? It's that crucial. It's that important that we had better take it seriously. That we had better do it the right way. We had better do it according to the Word of God. It's not, we're not playing tiddlywinks. I've heard it said like that, so I'll repeat that. We're not just playing some Christian game on our way to heaven. This is our whole life, and our whole purpose is to bring others to the cross and to keep others at the cross, because it is the cross that saves us. It is the cross that justifies us. It's the cross that sanctifies us. And in that day when I either pass away or Jesus Christ comes back for me, it will be the cross that will have brought me to my glorification. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. The cross is the glory of God.
Amen.
So understand the importance of his mission. What if Jesus Christ didn't come to die? Well, then all of humanity goes to hell. All of them. Every single person. For all have sinned. That's past tense. Everyone in the past has sinned once, at least. Okay? Some more than others.
Amen.
And all do come short of the glory of God. That's present. That's now. Even as a child of God, filled with the Holy Spirit, even though I'm preaching, even though there's works, there's fruit of the flesh, there is fruit of the flesh, I promise. There's fruit of the Spirit as well. Even though those things I've got, there's still things in me that I'm not changed into the image of Christ. So just understand, again, how crucial that his mission was, that we all come short, I come short, you come short of the glory of God. But thankfully, we have the blood, amen, which covers all sin. Thankfully, that just as in the Old Testament, when the high priest showed up once a year, he didn't show up without blood. That when he had to, on the Day of Atonement, when he had to atone for the sins of the entire nation, he brought that bowl of the Lamb's blood, he poured it on the Ark of the Covenant, and inside the Ark of the Covenant were the Ten Commandments. Okay, there were the budded rod of Aaron, and there was the jar of manna. Those three things symbolize just how sinful man is. You have the broken law. We've all broken the law, okay? And if you've broken one, you've broken them all, but most of us have broken them all.
Amen.
Okay, I understand most of us. I won't say most of us have broken them all, because not most people have killed somebody. But Jesus said, if you hate your brother, you have murdered him in your heart. So you really have broken them all.
Amen.
Me too, right? And then you had the budded staff. You know what the budded staff represented? It was man's rejection of God's leadership. When God had chosen Aaron to be the priest, the high priest, over all of the Israelites, they said, no, we don't like God's pick. We're going to come up with our own leaders, okay? We don't like Moses. Moses and Aaron, you guys are annoying. We don't like you anymore. They rejected God's pick. And then God had the experiment where he put, all the leaders had to put their rods in, but Aaron's rod budded. That represented man's rejection of God's way, God's leadership, God's institution. And of course, the jar of manna is a representation of man complaining when God had provided. That manna had come down, and they complained about that manna, and God gave them quail until they were sick, and I could go on and on about those things. But inside the Ark of the Covenant were this perfect illustration of how evil, how rebellious, and how foolish man is. And so when you see how sinful and awful that is in the middle of the Ark of the Covenant, you've got these two cherubim on top of the Ark of the Covenant looking down. They are a representation of God's judgment, of what God sees in judgment. When you've got the piercing gaze of the judgment of God looking down directly at the sin and rebellion of man, what do you have? Mm-hmm. Wrath.
Yeah.
Judgment. What we all deserve. That's a picture of outside of Christ what everyone is. That's what we have. But once a year, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest would bring in a bowl of blood into the Holy of Holies, and he would pour it upon the judgment seat, which we call the mercy seat. Without blood on it, it's the judgment seat. With blood on it, it's the mercy seat. Because as that blood would be poured on top of the Ark of the Covenant, instead of seeing the broken law, instead of seeing the budded rod of Aaron, instead of seeing the jars of manna, those seraphims representing the judgment of God no longer saw those things. All the judgment of God could see was the blood.
Amen.
All the judgment of God could see was the blood. Was the blood. Now, the blood of bulls and goats cannot take away sin, is what the author of Hebrews said, but it was a type and a picture of what Jesus Christ would do at Calvary's cross. When Jesus Christ was crucified, I was crucified with him. And as the blood poured out from his body, as the blood and the water poured out from his side, that blood came down the cross and it landed on the mercy seat of God. It landed between me and God. It landed between my sin and God's judging gaze. That's where the blood landed, and that's where the blood rests. That was for me. That was his mission. He is that high priest. But now, the only reason I'm in this covenant is because the Holy Spirit drew me into it. But how did he do that? He did it in part by anointing a God-called minister to present the gospel to me. What would the cross mean to me if I never came into it?
Amen.
Nothing. It was presented to me by a God-called minister. But not just that. It was also presented to me because that God-called minister was supported in his ministry. He was supported by his family, if he had one. He was supported by those who donated to his work to send him. It was supported by whatever ministry he was a part of. Understand that there was a whole lot more than just a preacher involved in my salvation. There was a whole lot of ordinary, everyday Christians, which I consider myself one, by the way. But there is a whole lot of people. And that's just one layer of it. If you look back and back and back, God was orchestrating bringing me that salvation plan all along. But I said that to say this. There are many Christians involved in that who God used in their own way, whether it was sitting in a prayer closet, praying for something they didn't even know they were praying for, speaking in tongues. Maybe somebody's tongues was, "Dear God, save Adam Denoon from Medicine Hat, Alberta, Canada. He's going to die and go to hell, and I need you to bring his salvation to him."
Amen.
Maybe that was some of their tongues. I don't know. But maybe that was somebody praying when they were called to be praying. Maybe it was somebody donating money to Jimmy Swagger Ministries when they were called to do so, because that was the ministry God used to bring me into the kingdom. So it's not just those of us who stand behind the sacred desk. It's not just those of us who sit behind the drums or the piano or stand up with the guitar. It's every single one of us as Christians have received the commission to be transformed into the image of Christ to bring others into salvation. That's your job. 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 Our responsibility is to follow the leading and the guiding of the Holy Spirit wherever he takes us. That's our job. Jesus Christ gave that commission. Just as my Father has sent me, so send I you.
Yes.
He's sending you. He's sending you. And you might think, well, I'm not, you know, I don't really feel like I'm called to be a missionary to another country or to stand up behind a pulpit or go to Bible college or anything like that. He's still sending you.
Yes.
He's still sending you. Where? Maybe your closet to pray. Maybe to the bank to get some money out for the minister. Maybe to that person at Taco Bell that you've seen 30 times and you've never mentioned to Jesus to them. Maybe to that person that you walk by on the street. I don't know where he's sending you. That's not for me to tell you. That's for the Holy Spirit to tell you. But your job is to remain sensitive. Wait a second. So this is all superintended by the Holy Spirit? Yes. Which is why Jesus said in that same sentence, when he said, I'm sending you, he said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Yeah. Receive ye the Holy Ghost. You cannot do in your life what God has called you to do to the degree that he has called you to do it without the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, without me, you can do what?
Nothing.
Nothing. A little bit?
Nothing.
I mean, we're talking about real fruit from the kingdom here. Nothing? You can produce no fruit without him? Well, how do you have him? He's sitting in heaven at the right hand of the Father. He himself, like physically, the glorified Jesus, is not in this room in a physical sense. In a physical sense, he is seated at the right hand of the Father. So how do we have Jesus today?
Through the Holy
Spirit. We have Jesus Christ himself. Now understand the concept of the Trinity. It is Jesus that we have in us, but it's through the agency of the Holy Spirit. You and I need the Holy Spirit. When we first come into Christ, there is a measure of the Holy Spirit given. You can't get saved without the Holy Spirit at all. But there's something interesting you need to understand about the disciples. After they received the Holy Spirit, remember Jesus breathed on them as an example in the room, and then after he ascended, they tarried in Jerusalem, and then Jesus' breath came again, but this time it came with a whole lot more. It came with the Holy Spirit. Everyone there, all the disciples, they were filled, were they not? They were filled with the Holy Spirit. And a lot of people look at that as just the receipt of the Holy Spirit. And it was. I mean, they did receive the Holy Spirit, but they were also filled with the Spirit. Not just receiving, but filled. So what's the difference here? Why then, if they received and were filled in Acts chapter 2, why is it that two chapters later we read about the same disciples getting filled with the Holy Spirit again? So if they've been given the Holy Spirit, they already have him. They've already started their work. They've already gone out. The Holy Spirit just pumped them up and filled them with glory. And they started going out and sharing the gospel, the mission of Christ, to men to bring them into salvation. And then all of a sudden, they're getting beat up. They're already out. They're already filled with the Spirit. They're getting beat up. When they're released, they all get together in a room to pray. Because they're like, man, we got to seek God. This is a whole lot more intense than we were thinking it was going to be. And they asked him for the boldness that they would need to continue their mission. And guess what God did in response to that prayer? He shook the foundations of that building as he filled them again with the Holy Spirit. Filled them again with the Holy Spirit. They were just at Pentecost. Okay? Barring maybe Azusa Street, there's never been anything like Pentecost. I mean, we've had revivals. The Holy Spirit's come. We've seen that all again. But they were just in like the greatest revival of all history at that time. They were just there. And why did they need to get filled again? Because they recognized, hey, this is a difficult task. God's calling us to do something that's beyond ourselves. We need more of the Holy Spirit. Well, guess what? Even if you have already been filled with the Spirit before, you still need the Holy Spirit to do what you need to do. You got to stay filled with the Holy Spirit. In the book of, I believe it's Ephesians, I probably have that wrong, but he said, be not full of wine, which is debauchery. That's what excess means there. In which is debauchery. But instead of being filled with wine, be filled with the Holy Spirit. But the tense that he spoke that in the Greek literally means continually be being filled with the Holy Spirit. Throughout your entire Christian life, you must be continuously being filled with the Holy Spirit. It's like a gas tank. And as you start getting a little weary in life, and you start looking at the natural, and you start seeing things in your heart that are discouraging, the enemy's roaring around you, trying to freak you out of the faith. Guess what? That needle starts getting down a little bit. You start getting discouraged. We all do.
Amen.
All of us. We start getting discouraged. Well, guess what I need? I need that needle of the Holy Spirit to go right back up to where it was before.
Amen.
I need to get filled with the Holy Spirit again.
Yes.
Now understand, when you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it's not something you lose. Or something that, say it this way, it's not something that just like leaves you. And you have to get baptized again and learn how to speak in tongues again. No, it's not like that. Once you got filled with the Holy Spirit, you got those tongues flowing, you can keep using them.
Right.
even if you haven't used them in a while. But it is true that as we continue to grow discouraged and our faith wavers, we tend to just ignore the Holy Spirit, and then all of a sudden we're dry. And as we're dry, guess what? Those opportunities to witness to other people, the need for fulfilling the commission properly, the importance of our commission starts decreasing in our hearts and lives. There's a solution for that. The same Holy Spirit that you got filled with before, go get some more.
Yeah.
Go get some more. The rock has already been stricken.
Yes.
The rock has already been stricken. There's already water pouring out of that rock.
Yes.
What was Moses supposed to do whenever they needed more water? Speak to the rock. Go back to the rock and speak to the rock. I need more water. Jesus, I need more water. I need more of the Holy Spirit. I need more. I'm dry. I'm thirsty. Give me more. And guess what? The same cross that brought you into Christ gives you access unlimited to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
It's the same blood. It's the same sacrifice. The blood is flowing out of the rock that has been stricken, and it's available to you. All you have to do is speak to the rock.
Yeah.
That's an act of faith.
That's good.
Lord, I need more. Lord, your mission was so important that if you disobeyed in any little way, all of mankind would perish for eternity. My mission, commission, is so integral that if I don't do what I'm called to do, then at least one other person will suffer for eternity because of my disobedience. That sink in a second. Wait, if I don't do it, won't God raise someone else? Maybe, sometimes, maybe. But if you don't do what God has called you to do, the work doesn't get done. That's like saying, well, oh, God will take care of it. God will take care of it. Well, guess what? You know what? There's still bad stuff that happens in this world.
Yes.
People still get murdered. People still get raped. People still blow each other up and cut each other's heads off. Why? Because we live in a world of sin. And it rains on the just and the unjust. And because of man's fallen condition, self-worship, not knowing God, evil things and horrible things happen. Well, guess what? When you and I neglect what God has called us to do, and we look to ourselves, and we walk in the flesh, and we ignore the Holy Spirit and what He's called us to do, evil things happen, including people going to hell.
Amen. That's right.
Every second, I can't remember what the exact statistic, I believe that just in this country, it's like less than 2 seconds, someone dies.
Wow.
Someone dies in this country just about every second. How many of these that are dying right now are going to hell? How many of these are someone you may have met? How many of these are someone you may have come across? How many of these went to a church that you went to where there was a minister who maybe could have reached them? Who asked for an offering and you didn't give? How many of these did God intend for you to seek Him for in tongues in your prayer closet? I stopped, but it's not stopping.
That's right.
I stopped that, but the commission has not stopped. You have a heavy responsibility. Now it's heavy for Him. We don't strive all the way to the cross, Jesus said, like He did. We don't strive unto blood. But what we do is so important. Not just what I do behind this pulpit, not just what the leadership in this church does, but what you do with your time that you're given, with the money that you're given. And I'm not just talking about giving offerings. Financial responsibility, I'm first in line. I'm learning. I haven't been as good a steward as I could be because of just old ways of thinking in this country and how we manage our finances and stuff like that. I'm learning that right now, and I'm not here to preach money to you, but just things in each of our lives that God is calling us to be better stewards of. Our time, our finances, our efforts, how much other things take up real estate here in our brains, it's an important thing. And you and I, as believers, there's two judgments, and I'm going to wrap up pretty quick here. There's two different judgments going on for the end of days. There's the great white throne judgment, which thankfully all who are in Christ will be spared of. And that is where those who don't have their names written in the Lamb's Book of Life will be officially declared guilty and cast into hell. The other judgment is the judgment seat of Christ, where you and I, as believers, will answer directly to Christ about what we did or did not do with what we're given. Okay? There's two ways to build. And I'm not going to go too far into this, but there's wood, hay, and stubble, and there's gold and silver and precious jewels. Gold, silver, and precious jewels is everything that we build that's according to the cross. The mission of Christ, the commission that he's given us to bring others into the kingdom, to be conformed into the image of Christ. Then there's wood, hay, and stubble. Those things that we do that are self-motivated, those things that are not wrapped up in the cross, those and other things. And all of us have a lot of wood, hay, and stubble. Okay? Some of us more than others. Okay? But you and I will answer to Christ. And all those things that we thought we were doing right in and building up correctly, the judgment of Christ will burn those things up and we will suffer a loss of reward. You might think, well, you know, if I can just make the smoking section of heaven, I'm happy. No, and that's carnal thinking. That is carnal thinking. If you and I truly believe that if you and I understood just how important our eternal rewards were, if we understood just how great the treasures in heaven that we're building are, we would not be okay with losing any reward at all. We would not be okay with losing any of that reward. And especially knowing that due to our inaction, due to our disobedience to the Holy Spirit, others didn't get the chance to make it to where we are. All right? So understand just how important Christ's mission was, and just as important as his mission was, so too is our commission. Because the cross can only work for those who are drawn to the cross by the Holy Spirit. And how does the Holy Spirit draw others to the cross? Yes, he does a work. When they hear it, faith comes. Faith comes by hearing. But how can they hear? This is in the Bible, okay? I'm not making this up. How can they hear without a preacher? If the preacher doesn't preach, they don't hear it. They don't get the faith, so they don't get saved, and they don't go to heaven. But how can a preacher preach unless he is sent? If you're not sending preachers and supporting preachers, how are they going to preach? People go to hell. And it's not just, again, I'm using that train of thought that the Word of God uses, and because Paul was specifically dealing with offerings at that point. But it's not just our tithing. It's our obedience to the Holy Spirit in everything that we do. Yes. Whether it's prayer, whether it's doing certain things and not doing certain things. Everything is to be building the gold, silver, and precious jewels of our reward in heaven, which is everything that is geared towards bringing others into the kingdom. If I don't cling to the cross in my daily life, I won't be walking after the Spirit and following after the Spirit and being changed, therefore, into the image of Christ and bringing others into the kingdom. That's what I'm trying to tell you. You cling to the cross to do that. So there's two instructions that I'm going to give you here as I begin to close. But listen, there's two instructions that you've got to walk out of here with. If you walk out of here with anything, it's got to be these two things, okay? The first thing is cling to the cross in your daily life. That means continuously trust what Jesus Christ did at Calvary for you for everything. If you've got anxiety, bring Jesus into that anxiety. He died for that issue.
Hallelujah.
If you've got depression, bring Jesus into that depression. He died for that issue. That's what it means to apply the cross to all these issues. If you've got an alcohol problem, bring Jesus in. Oh no, I gotta clean up the problem. Hang on, Jesus, wait at the door and knock for a little bit. I gotta clean this up first. No. Jesus, my house is dirty. Come in.
Yes.
Come in.
Yes.
Bring him in. And that's not just for getting saved, that's for everything.
That's
as you walk in your life, as you grow discouraged, as you mess up, bring Jesus in by faith. Trust what he did at Calvary for that issue. Cling to the cross. And as a result of clinging to the cross, then the Holy Spirit has the legal right to work in your heart.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit has a legal right to work in your heart. But here's where we come to the second thing. The Holy Spirit only works according to the measure of the Spirit that God has given. You can have a relative living in your house and never really have much to do with that relative. Anyone have in-laws or roommates or anything that you don't really see much, but they live in your... Well, you don't have basements here, but... When you can have someone in your house and not really have a whole lot to do with them. When you received Christ, the Holy Spirit came in to live in your house. But some of you might not have been walking in the full measure of the Spirit, being filled with the Spirit, having the Spirit in every room of your house, walking in proper relationship with Him. So this morning, not only do you walk out of here knowing you got to cling to the cross, but I'm going to give an altar call. Really for two types of people. One, for those who have never received the Holy Spirit at all. That is those who have never placed their trust in Christ for salvation, for sanctification. Those who have not accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior yet. That's the first group of people. The second group of people I want to call up to the front are those who have never been filled with the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. If you are in either group of those people, I'll be calling you up to the front in just a minute. But understand, you need the Holy Spirit to do what you got to do. And you got to be filled with the Holy Spirit to do what you got to do. And it is so important because people are perishing. Amen. Would you stand this morning?